Here is one of the great success stories in Ireland of the last 50 years, a simple idea which succeeded beyond all expectations, an idea which generated great community involvement and a heightened sense of environmental and architectural heritage.
An idea that picked the tourist industry off the ground and gave a facelift to almost every town and village in Ireland.
But to understand the humble beginnings and the origins of the Tidy Towns competition, well, you have to waft back in time to an Ireland which was much more black and white.
Let's journey back to the 1950s. Ireland in the 50s had all the symptoms of an impoverished and demoralised society. Severe unemployment led to mass emigration, and in the census of 1961, the population dropped to an all-time low of 2.8 million people.
There were consequences for the rural landscape too, which gradually became deserted and dotted with derelict homes. Thankfully, there was some hope. Steps towards economic expansion began, and Bord Fáilte was established to develop the tourist market.
In most of the towns and villages, there were only two colours of paint, green and black, dark green. And there were lots of dirt and everything like that. And there was no activity apart from an occasional cattle fair or something like that. And one of the airlines, Pan Am, I think it was, said, well, what we must do is we must make the country interesting, worth visiting. And as a result of that, we set up Antostal. And Antostal had 57 committees, and our one objective was to create activities right through the country so the visitor, wherever he went, there was something to visit, something to do. And that, and out of that, those 57 committees, funnily enough, just when the Tidy Towns came into existence, they were part of the structure on which you were able to set up the new structure of the Tidy Towns committees.
So, Aidan, what did it actually involve, getting the message to the people?
It involved really hoofing around the country with one of these, a collapsible screen in the back of the car, and a whole set of transparency slides and all the other gadget bits and pieces, and some leaflets and brochures and so on. Remember, this was all before television. People cycled in from all surrounding the town or village, you know. This was a huge attraction for people to come along and see what we showed them in the way of colour transparencies, and show them what should be done.
In that first year, the response was good. 52 towns entered, and the first ever Tidy Towns winner officially was Glenties in County Donegal.
There was already a tradition of an annual clean-up for Glenties Corpus Christi procession, so the parish priest suggested they give an extra push and prepare for the new competition.
And out of this sprung so much publicity that in the next year the entries rose from 52 to 179. Glenties got the hang of what the judges were after and took the prize again in 1959 and 1960. Many came to see what the fuss was all about, including tourists, other Tidy Towns enthusiasts, and even journalist priests.
Does it look tidy? Well, you know it should, because this is Glenties, County Donegal, winner of the Tidy Towns competition of Ireland for the last 3 years in succession. In fact, since the competition started in 1958, Glenties has reigned supreme over all the other towns and villages of Ireland.
After three consecutive wins, Glenties was getting very used to the Tidy Towns title until it was knocked off its perch in 1961 by this real charmer in County Carlow. No, not you, Michael. Rathvilly.
But then Glenties won the title back the next year.
And Rathvilly won it back again the year after that, and then a few years later in 1968. This is a town that just spells history.
Smells history.
And their record as entrants is historic too, as this year they are entering the competition for the 50th time.
Tidy Towns has an enemy.
And to be honest, not normally something that we like to sing about. So please, please don't leave your litter about. Don't throw it everywhere when you go out. A coast-to-coast rubbish dump is not our land. The message of the song we know you'll understand.
Now, I have gathered here some litter, which I want to show to you and ask you, what is the most common type of litter that I have got here? Now, Claire?
Crisp bags.
Crisp bags. Where do all the crisp bags come from?
Us, the children.
And why?
Because we eat the most crisps.
And when you're finished with your crisps, what do?
We throw them in the ground.
Interesting facts about Virginia.
It was named after Elizabeth I, otherwise known as the Virgin Queen, hence Virginia. It's situated on Loch Ramor. It's halfway between Dublin and Enniskillen, and it won the Tidy Towns title in 1964 and 65.
With one main street, the layout hasn't changed since the double win in the 60s.
But these days, there are more people, there's more business, more traffic, and more entertainment.
Virginia may have been wearing the Tidy Towns crown for 64 and 65, but meanwhile, up the road, Bally James Duff was cleaning up its act and hoovered up the coveted title for the next 2 years.
Not that this town needed to put itself on the map.
Thanks to this guy, Percy French, a drainage inspector, and his song about Paddy Riley, they were already there.
Oh, the grass, it is green around Valley James Duff, and the blue sky is over it all.
The sky isn't quite so blue, and much of the grass might have been sacrificed for new buildings. Even he doesn't hit the right note, as this is modelled on local shopkeeper Fintan Cronin, since apparently no one really knew what Percy French actually looked like.
Paddy Shafley, you're not involved in the competition anymore, but you were one of the longest-serving judges over the years, and indeed you've even written a book about the Tidy Towns competition. What was it that drew you to it?
My late wife, Maura, and myself were final adjudicators, and we suddenly were given this great opportunity, historic opportunity, of travelling around Ireland, looking at towns and villages, communicating with the people, and suddenly you begin to see, well, the most important place for anybody is where they live. And here you have a competition started by, we say, the tourist board, and suddenly exceeds beyond all expectations.
And Paddy, if we hadn't had the competition, how different a place would Ireland be?
That smaller towns and villages could very easily have become indistinguishable from each other, that they would have lost their interesting characteristics, like the Tidy Towns sort of built up on the specific personalities and characteristics and tidy them up and improve them. So I think Ireland would be a duller place, more monotonous, much more monotonous.
It was in 1969 that Tyrrell's Pass became our national Tidy Towns champion. And 10 years later, they were still talking about it.
Even on a winter's day, the green at Tyrrell's Pass, County Westmeath, makes a pleasant impression on the visitor.
The village name came from the Anglo-Norman family, the Tyrrells, who owned several castles in the area, the main one being in the village itself. Later on, it became an estate village and was built to its present layout by Jane, Countess of Belvedere.
Hopefully, Jane and the Tyrrell family would have approved of how their village looks today. And the green here still makes a pleasant impression on the visitor.
In 1970, and again in 1990, the Tidy Towns Award travelled northwards, this time to the northernmost tip of the country. On the Inishowen Peninsula, south of Malin Head.
This is Malin Town.
The town is approached by the 18th century 10-arched bridge.
And for its years, this old triangular green is still in great shape.
That does take enormous community commitment and community effort, but it's also part of your own pride in Malin, and you've passed that on to the next generation.
After its second win, the town had a guest of honour, the newly elected president, whose mother came from the area. She also turned up in other towns over the years, as did presidents before and after her.
I wondered why there was always such presidential interest, so I decided to set out for the residence of the president.
Community is a place where we care for one another in all the vast ways that it matters. What Tidy Towns brings to it, I think, in a very special way, is the care for place. Because every one of us knows, you know, if your house is a mess and, you know, there's not much joy in living in a house that's in a perpetual mess. But the day that you make the effort and you do the cleaning up and you have the bit, you know, that you have the flowers on the table and the place is lovely and clean, your heart lifts and it gives you a kind of a great surge of energy and a surge of pride. And what Tidy Towns has introduced us to over the last 50 years of its existence is how, with a bit of collaborative effort, working together, we can bring that same pride to our community. We can understand our community differently. We can make it beautiful.
And of course, in travelling around the country, sharing the presidency with those communities as you do, you've probably seen the before and after effect, have you?
I have. Year on year, over these 50 years, I mean, we've been astounded at some of the things that have been accomplished through Tidy Towns. And I've seen some fantastic transformations, some really inventive things out there, because Tidy Towns, is it, people sort of associate it with, you know, with the hanging baskets and the flowers, but then you've seen them do wonderful things with landscape, with riverscapes, with townscapes that maybe had been forgotten or overlooked or neglected, turning them back into objects of beauty and giving people a real sense of pride in their history as well as everything else. It's the beginning to understand your place more deeply, to understand the richness of its heritage more broadly, to understand, in a sense, what a kind of a sacred stewardship you have for all of that in this generation, and how, by working together, everybody doing their little bit, using all their different sets of skills, you can really make something to be proud of, but also making your mark in this generation so that the next generation have something really brilliant to build on.
A County Cavan town climbed on the Tidy Towns throne for the fifth time in 1971. This time it wasn't Virginia or Ballyjamesduff, but Ballyconnell, a town named after the first century Celtic warrior, Conall Ciornach.
Only a mile from the border with Northern Ireland, Ballyconnell is on the Shannon Earn waterway, originally built 150 years ago as a commercial route.
Thank you.
Now the commercial activity has moved into the town, where many new businesses have opened to service its growing population.
Trim is a natural beauty on the banks of the River Boyne, and it was always a tidy town's hot ticket, becoming champion in 1972. It became a champion again in 1974, and yet again in 1984.
But that wasn't enough for Tidy Trim, who made it to an Oscar win in 1994 when it starred with Mel Gibson in the film Braveheart.
Well, at least the castle did, anyway.
Built by the de Lacy family in the late 12th and 13th century, it was a significant Norman stronghold in Ireland and only one of the ruins in this County Meath town, which is brimming with heritage. The gardens of Wicklow have to be perfect pickings for the Tidy Towns competition.
And when this village, named after St. Tegan, won the title in 1973, it was, not unnaturally, the talk of the town.
Just two pubs and one shop, this village is very much home to a farming community.
With its main attractions being Humewood Castle, the mountain scenery,
and this, the glorious silence. Yes, villages like Kilteagan still have dreams to scoop the main award a second time. And here a member of the original winning committee of 35 years ago passes on tips to her granddaughter. But success always depends on the people, on individuals, on committees. I wondered what made a good committee. Or a good chairperson for that matter. So I decided to chair my very own meeting with some of the stalwarts of Tidy Towns committees around the country. What do you think is the secret of a good committee?
You must be proud of your village, but it's also essential that you be able to tell the difference between a weed and a flower.
The quality of the committee member rather than the quantity.
Decision making and action.
A committee should be made up of candors, not looking for reasons why not to start, to just go ahead and solve their problems on the way.
Experience, enthusiasm and fresh ideas.
What's the secret to that?
Teamwork and dedication.
I think that the committee working together and having respect for each other's opinions.
The essentials for a good committee is a certain amount of madness, to keep very focused.
I think you need a team of good communicators who can get the message out to the neighbourhood.
A good committee member is somebody who's a good team player and a motivator.
We can talk a lot, but at the end of the day, you have to get up and get out and get the job done.
This pretty Tipperary village was twice a winner in 1975 and 1979. Kilsheelan
sits between the Cumara Mountains on the Waterford side and on the Tipperary side, the Slieve na Mon.
As well as a good record in geography, Kilsheelan does okay in the history stakes as well.
The village was discovered to be a rich and important one when the Normans took over because this stretch of the river shore became the main merchandise route from Clonmel to Waterford and the sea.
The tradition was that the overall winning town or village would host the awards ceremony the following year. Then there was a move to the Royal Hospital Kilmainham and more recently to Dublin Castle. But wherever the ceremony moved, RTE was sure to follow.
for the past 50 years, we have seen these two institutions grow in strength side by side with each other, and there is a real fit between them. If you think back to the early 1960s, Father Peter Lamass and the RERC team were amongst the first people to feature the Tidy Towns programme as early as 1962.
We're trying to find out about this Tidy Town. Do you think it's made much difference to the people here since they won the Tidy Town competition?
Oh, I think it has. I think the people are very taken a great interest in it.
Radio played a large part in keeping the spirit of this competition alive, particularly I think of John Bowman's role in this throughout the 80s and 90s. And of course, television news has always been prominent in featuring the various winners and the undoubted pride that people take in their town, their village, achieving a national result.
The question is, how did it achieve it? What's the secret of that success?
And then, as years have progressed nationwide, this very programme has become a very important part of relaying this important national event to the whole public.
And we'll be bringing you the announcement of the prize winners in the five main categories. And they are Tidiest Village, Tidiest Small Town, Tidiest Large Town, Tidiest Large Urban Centre, and of course then the overall winner.
And if you think back again towards that start in the early 1960s, there were perhaps 300,000 or 400,000 television sets in the country. There are now 1.4 million. So we've all grown together. Our awareness of the importance of civic pride has grown also. And I think that this is a fit with...